So when I first spent what basically became an afternoon with Johanna Breiding's work, Andrea, right?
Yep.
I was like actually shocked. I'm kind of embarrassed at how shocked I was that the writing was not credited to Johanna, that it wasn't just Jennifer's voice reading the piece, but that it was actually also Jennifer's writing, kind of. So Jennifer Moon and Johanna explained that their process was really intermingled and interwritten, and its radicality made me so their voices should be included here today. Michelle Dizon, who you'll also be hearing from, is a writer and a filmmaker and an educator and a cultural reflector in ways that are rare. And her work resists the more comfortable boundaries between writing and visual work, politics, and praxis. Okay. I should also say that we share what I think it's safe to say is a mentor in Trinity Minha, which is a kind of inarticulable but palpable, I think, kind of kinship. So, and Amy Sanchez-Arteaga and me talk last.
Hey.
Our form cognate collective, and their work engages borders and the porousness of borders, among many other complicated ideas. They blur the inherent kind of fixity of borders and the stridency of their upkeep in ways that continue to unfold to me, and I think to all of you as well. So I'm happy to have all of these thinkers and feelers and makers here today. And that's that.
Oh. Hi. Hello. Oh, can you hear me? Okay, hi. Hi. My name is Jennifer Moon, and this is...
I'm Johanna Breiding.
And as Latia mentioned, we're going to talk about this video essay that Johanna asked me to participate in, where she asked me to write about her mother, Andrea's death, as if I was Johanna. So maybe do you want to talk about the video in the show Epitaph for Family a little bit?
Sure. Yeah, so I had a show in June at Human Resources Gallery, and it was called Epitaph for Family. It consisted of a 5-channel video and 60mm film installation, a sculptural painting, 2 series of photographs, one of which was shown on a 35mm slide projector. The others were queer still lifes, which we'll look at a few digital prints. And the last piece was this video essay that I did in collaboration with Jennifer Moon and Carrie Cronenwet, who's here today, who edited the film.
So I think maybe since, like, I'm going to start with kind of like how Johanna and I met and like leading up to Johanna asking me to write for this video. So Johanna, you can go ahead and put the monitor. So Johanna and I met Johanna when she was a guest on Keen O'Brien's radio show on King Chung. And so I met Johanna, and soon after I met Johanna, I sent her this Facebook message, basically saying like, hey, I think you're cute. You want to, you know, maybe if you're interested, you want to get some coffee or juice or a studio visit. And and yeah, so that's how it started. And Johanna kindly responded saying that like she had just gone through a breakup and that her heart and hands were full. We ended up doing a studio visit, and it was great. And
A few studio visits.
Yeah, a few studio visits. And a lot of what we're going to talk about is about trust. Trust also, and also trust while there's a simultaneous distance, because like we don't know each other really, you know. I mean, we know each other more now, but like at the time when she asked me, we didn't really know each other that well. So that was like our first introduction. Then so I was a part of the Made in LA show in 2014, and part of the show was this book called The Book of Eros. And the Book of Eros is a chronological compendium of all the people that I ever had a crush on, obsessed over, had sex with, and or entered a romantic relationship since I made this deal with this cosmic entity to forfeit all romantic relations in exchange for my art career to flourish. So the last person, there were like, I think 33 people in it, and the very last person was Johanna. So at the opening, Johanna was there, and I was like, hey, Johanna, you're in this book, by the way. And Johanna kind of looked a little surprised. So I took her over to the book, and I'm like, here's your page. It's modeled off of like the Dungeons and Dragons monster manual. So each person has scored, like, I don't know if you can see this. Oh, here. So this is like a statistics block that scores, like, it's not really about the people in the book, but about me, like my obsessiveness towards a person. So, and then there's a lore in it that kind of describes sort of like our relationship, or but it's written in the language, the elven language of Tengwar, so no one can read it unless you know Tengwar. So.
I don't know Tengwar.
So then a little bit after, I mean, after then Johanna sent me another Facebook message saying like, hey, what did you write about me, by the way? And so then I sent her this translation of what I wrote. Maybe you can talk about like, because Johanna mentioned that like when my initial Facebook message to Johanna kind of like initiated this immediate trust. And then maybe like when I showed Johanna the book, she was like, what the fuck, you know, like, and then maybe this sort of like lack of trust or like what's going on. And then after I sent you the message, maybe, you know, a regaining of trust. So maybe you can talk a little bit about that.
I think when I asked you to write this text, I realized I also wanted to share a form of intimacy with you, a different kind of intimacy. I think there was something about your frankness and you being very direct in your approach. I mean, even though it was over Facebook, but it was still like a very direct message that I appreciated. And at the Hammer Museum, I almost felt like it was like stalkerish or like bordering on like her stalking me and 32 other people, I guess. And I was like, oh, well, I would never do that. I would ask someone's permission. But I also, when I asked her for this, I was like, okay, it was more about you than me or your relationship to intimacy than mine. So I think just because of that direct communication and when I knew I wanted to make this piece, I started writing it. I thought I would be the writer and I couldn't do it. I think it was something that really started making me feel very emotional and too subjective. And so I thought it would be very interesting to ask someone who I didn't know that well at that time, who also I wouldn't consider as someone whose writing is a major part of their practice. But I think because of these studio visits and the way that you interact with people, you had learned so much about me through these visits that I also felt like I wouldn't have to repeat myself. Like, you knew so much, and it felt like a way to distance myself from something that was one of the most vulnerable things that happened in my life. And kind of giving you back that trust that I felt like you gave to me.
Mm-hmm. Did you at first consider writing it yourself?
I started writing it myself and then came to a block and stopped, and I actually thought I would ask my girlfriend Cho or, you know, two of my best friends who I consider very good writers. But I think there was something about you that I also know that you haven't lost a parent that I thought it would be very interesting to have your voice basically take over my story without you having to feel that sense of vulnerability because you haven't experienced that form of loss.
Yeah, and this is a still from the video.
Yeah, so this is a video still. My mom, and that's my brother Chintz in the corner.
Do you want to show the video now?
Yeah.
And then we can talk. Okay, yeah. So we'll show the video.
The video is, I think, about 10 minutes long, so we'll show that, and then we'll talk a little bit more in depth about the process.
Imagine there is a death, but there is no end. In 2007, my mother died, an unusual death, a freak accident. The loss of my mother shifted me, pushed me off center, askew to a world faithfully oriented around family. The purity of love embodied in the identity of a mother, and mine was gone forever. Death signifies an end, but the death of a loved one lives forever. In 1997, there was another death, the death of an assumed identity. I felt the determination of identity forcing its way down my throat, and I refused to swallow. It lodged itself in my throat and began to suffocate me. So I killed it. This death also shifted me, pushed me off center, askew to a world faithfully oriented around the family. The ghostly residue of the dead, it lingers. The death of a mother. The death of an identity. The death of the family. They all linger, waiting. Do they linger and wait for us to visit them again in moments of longing, to resurrect in an integration of memory, to suspend in a perpetual state of undead, a unifying space where the living and dead become one, caught in an existence that is half alive and half dead. And able to fall apart in order to create a new certainty falling into place. No, it is the living who refuse to let the dead dissolve completely into death. This space of the undead, where we keep the dead alive, where is it located? Is it beyond the horizon that my eyes fixate on? Be grounded, situated in bodies of water with unseeable depth, atop balconies that beckon us to fall? Or is it located in the act of orientation, in the effect of inhabitants, fixated within the richest structures, where everything aligns momentarily, in perfect unison, to mean the same thing? I watched these reels from my childhood, the old panel footage, looking for something. The broad depth. Searching for clues. The refracted light of the sun that cuts through an indestructible moving portrait of my mother and father, standing side by side for the camera as an ideal couple, becomes proof of a queer cosmos. These points of pressure fracture into a comfort valley breaking apart in the depth of horizons. I return to these projections of family also seeking something. They create additional points of pressure that rupture inside me. If there is comfort found in disruption, deviation, breaking apart and falling, then there is comfort here too, in the collapse of horizons, in the disorientation of free fall, in the bottomless abyss of the sea, and in the death of my mother. My memories become shells, architecture for the dead to reside. Feelings remain abstract and in flux, transitional and unstable, but the details of my location in space and time, my points of orientation to the physical world, are inescapable. I remember dates, times, smells. A bat landing on my head. An aging enchantress wearing an infinity necklace, reading my future on strange cards that I've never before seen. Odd occurrences that now seem like premonitions of death. I recall my precise locations, the distinct direction I am facing the world, details of man-made designs, and the omnipresence of horizons and bodies of water. A lake 18 years ago, a river 8 years ago. Why is it that during these moments of death, I stand atop ledges that play with our fascination of falling? I am beckoned into free fall, but instead I create steps with these house memories within tiered shells. A grounding in familiar objects, architecture I can grasp, all of it to prevent disorientation. I have used my memories to conjure magic ones in an attempt to raise the dead. We were lodged deeply in a state of unconsciousness, where we imagine time, space, orientations, objects, and others no longer exist. I search my memories for all the worldly things that brought me joy. All the things you had once loved that would now entice your senses back into this world of relations. Your favorite roses, handpicked by your expert hands, from 150 different varieties. The song you danced to in the arms of your first and only lasting love, spinning you around in love-bound circles as it sang how wonderful you look tonight. I brought these temporal artifacts to you as offerings and incantations, gathering them around you as we gather around tables to form bonds of family, of friendship, of community. Your body figures a tabletop to arrange a still land of memories, compositions and sounds, whispers, touches and caresses, embodied in wilting flowers, near empty hourglasses, and buttery masses of fat alongside sea creatures have lost their way home. They congregate in ever-shifting formations to steady their horizon and prevent you from quivering into a maze of collapsing memories. The complexity of my emotions begins to gather as well, infinite and disparate, creating disturbances and deviations in their inability to align with the horizon of constructive memories. The slippage of emotions allows the moments of disorientation to gather in a place, as if they were queer bodies or on a different table, a table that propels us to face a different way, away from the rupturing of the horizon. Without a stable paradigm of orientation, gravity reality becomes an illusion. Relative positions of above and below, before and after, when self and others no longer exist. Boundaries collapse in the free fall. And it is here, in falling, in liminal space, where perspectives twist and fold into one another, that I understand death and life to be the same.
So I should maybe say that the Epitaph for Family show is about love, loss, and queer family making. And I was using the horizon line as this kind of directional tool and form that would lead you through the gallery. And so the centerpiece was the five-channel video installation called Magic Hour, where I asked nine different queer people that are close to me to talk about their own personal relationships to family and loss, and they were all seated at these table lines. So the horizon of the oceans then led to these three table lines that would alternate. And then for this piece, that was definitely the most challenging one for me, I had my dad's girlfriend ship these VHS tapes from Switzerland that had been in the basement for a very long time. And it was about 30 hours of footage that I watched three times. And then Carrie was living in Berlin, and I was basically taking notes for him of the parts that I would want, choosing basically three things. One, which was the disruption of that horizon. So I didn't want anything that was horizontal or clean, so a lot of the movements either within the footage are making an infinity shape or a circle, or through disruptions of my father's hand holding the camera, or interferences with the light or the media, I guess. Two was finding moments of queer interaction. So like there's that part where I'm wearing a mask and then I'm flipping it and I'm going and I'm actually kissing all the girls in my kindergarten class. But for me, I was like, wait, it was like it took for me to have a mask on and then flip that on its head, and that then allowed me to go and try and find these moments of intimacy. And the third was looking for moments where my mother was exiting the frame. So thinking that the only footage I have of her that holds her movement is within this footage. So this three-way collaboration was happening, although Jennifer Moon and Carrie Cronenwood had not met. So Jennifer and I were working together you were working on the text, and I would like read it and maybe edit it or tell you like this should be removed or this should be added. And with Carrie, the same thing would happen, where he was working with the visuals and the edits.
Yeah, it's also interesting because like I haven't seen that this in a while. How do you feel when you watch this?
Well, at Human Resources, it was small, and there was two seats, like how we're sitting, and you would have headphones. So I actually would like for people to watch it more like intimacy. So I think for me it was strange knowing that it was this big, but I don't know, I've seen it so many times.
Yeah. I start getting like goosebumps a little bit. I don't know, there's something, it's like, because it's like my voice, but then like, you know, the text that I wrote, I then, you know, gave to Carrie, and then Carrie took the text and edited it for the video. So there's this like, a letting go, like your experience, and then you gave to me. So it's like, like all these deaths are happening. Like you gave it to me, and like this trusting that I would then, you know, do something with it that is sort of that's representative of you in some kind of spirit, and then like me giving it to Carrie, and then trusting Carrie that like would take it and then make it into this video. And I don't know, there's some, and when I was watching, I was like, It seemed like, even though it was my voice, it seemed like a little bit someone else, because it's also like I wrote this. It's not a style of writing that I write at all, and that was like one of the biggest challenges, was to write it as if I was Johanna. It was actually one of the hardest things I had to write. I remember telling my friends that like this thing is trying to kill me, like this, like write this piece of writing, and like and also we were talking a lot about like how do you queer death, or the queering of death, and like a letting go of self. So that when I'm saying this, and because like when I watch it, it doesn't seem like it's me saying it. Mm-hmm. Like it does feel like it's you or something. But I was just curious if you...
I mean, everything that's said is the truth, but I almost also feel removed in a way where I'm hoping, because there's not, like, specific details, maybe, that it could also relate to other people who I've, like, either have experienced this or will at some point. Mm-hmm. Because it's not my text. It's my story, but it's not my text. And this footage is not my footage, even though I'm in it. I can't remember any of this, so it's almost like even watching this, I know, like that's me on the right, but I don't remember this moment. So I think there's something very interesting happening with memory in terms of seeing oneself as a younger version, and also I think storytelling, that I tell you the stories how I remember them, whereas if my brother were to tell you, maybe they would be slightly different. Mm-hmm.
And also, you originally wanted, you were going to narrate it, and you tried to, right?
Mm-hmm.
Narrate it, and then
yeah, I think there's something about your voice that is very, like, monotone, right? So I think if I were to talk, I would probably start getting, like, a squeaky voice, have a tiny bit of an accent. I think it would be more subjective. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because it's like... I feel like it's like hard to place or something, my emotions or something, when watching it, that it kind of bounces around, similar to kind of maybe what you're trying to get at with your entire show, in terms of like, because I think like you were saying, like when you didn't, there's something that happens with emotions when it gets too personal, that it becomes like alienating, and then so you're trying to, my understanding is that you're trying to reach this kind of like sweet spot or something, you know, of entry, but still maintaining like a intense intimacy.
Trinity Minha yesterday said, letting form go is accepting mortality. And I don't know exactly what she meant, but I wrote that down and started thinking about it. And I think for me, in doing this process with you and with you, Carrie, did feel like a way of like coming to acceptance, or through distancing myself though simultaneously. Like it feels so vulnerable. Part of me is like, okay, everyone in here now knows this thing about me, but I also feel like there's something that actually you, Michelle, being my teacher at CalArts, you know, taught me to not be scared of making personal work. And at CalArts, I started thinking about making work about my mom, and I feel like this was the first attempt that is also, yeah, thanks to you. Letting form go is accepting mortality. So I think for me, I took that as like my relationship to form is like, was the horizon for this show, or being a photographer, it like is very much like always framing things, seeing everything in squares or rectangulars, where is this footage, even though obviously it is a rectangular format, it feels like it's not my form, it's not my filmmaking, it's not my text, it's not my voice, it's not my decisions of editing.
When thinking about this, just like the presentation, I kept thinking about like there's like this core, like a core belief, either that like we can really know a person or we can never know a person. Like, can we ever really know another person? And some people think yes or no. And for me to do this, like I had to, and I do believe this, I had to believe that I can know someone. Like I can truly know another person in order for me to like kind of do this project. which I can't, you know, I'm thinking just about, like, I've been thinking a lot about, like, beliefs and belief entities and, like, the things that prevent me from, you know, if I, because if I, I don't know, sometimes maybe I get, like, that's maybe a scary idea to some people or something. I don't know, what do you think about that? Was that part of, like, the part of how you were able to let go of this story or experience, not just the story, but it's a, like, a really intense experience?
And yeah, I think it's sharing. I think there's something about, I don't know, I care about making work more collectively. And I think just being, like, utterly vulnerable and sharing that, because I think by doing so, you're then, like, telling a truth or something that I think no one can really take from you or, like, yeah, I mean, even in the, I have this, like, little catalog where I asked, so Jennifer Moon's text is in here, and it's actually a longer version than the narration in this video essay, but I also asked one of my best friends, Milena Dom, to write a text, and she wrote it in a letter form that's addressing both me and her mother. Her mother had cancer at the time and has died just recently. And then Maggie Nelson also wrote a text because my exhibition opened just a few days after they legalized gay marriage in the US. And it was like a critique on that to some point. And Maggie Nelson's book, The Argonauts, also had just been released. And then Don Romsberg, who's a parent and one of the participants in the Magic Hour video, wrote a text about his marriage to his husband and him adopting two African-American girls. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think there's something about sharing or I don't know if giving, but I don't know if that answered your question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We were going to talk about process, but we didn't really get into that. But maybe it's also good to point out that, like, a lot of the text was also based on, like, queer theory, which I am so bad with reading. Like, I don't, like, know anything. So, like, one of our first meeting was, like, Johanna showing me footage and, like, kind of retelling her experience through the footage. And then, you know, and then...
I think the second one, I brought you all the books. I was like, yeah. I'm reading... So, like, this, her text starts off with saying, imagine there is a death, but there is no end. And in Hito Sterl's text, in Free Fall, A Thought Experiment on Vertical Perspective, she says, imagine you are falling, but there is no ground. So it's kind of loosely basing, some of the text, I think, is based off of
a lot of
thinkers.
It is. I mean, a lot writers. Of it, what I did was I took, like, almost, like, very straightforward, like Hito's opening line and then kind of changing it to talk about, like, death, mm-hmm. inquiring death, and then also taking specific sentences about, like, orientation in the horizon line and then kind of fitting it, like, changing it so that it's, like, to fit, like, this text about death specifically with,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Which was also challenging. does anyone have any questions? Yes.
Thank you for this presentation. I'm really close to the work because we have a very intimate relationship and. I also hosted the first tier talk in the context of this, specifically this work. And Jennifer and Johanna both spoke about this intermingling. And I think one thing, it's not really a question, I just want to speak on it because I think it, I don't know, I'm just, whatever, I feel like talking. I think a lot about, like, this work really brings to mind the idea that the queer body, both individual and collective, it can be a site of disaster. And of pain and of confusion. And I think what's really amazing about the triangle of collaboration that produced this piece is that there's this kind of queer dimensionality to this, to the idea of telling someone's story and the care and intimacy that is necessary for telling that story that maybe the sole author can't tell due to traumas or to being a kind of a site of disaster. I think it's like, I don't know, it just speaks to this kind of, I think you're queering the idea of storytelling by constantly shifting the ownership of whose voice, the editing voice is different, the video editing voice is different than the speaking voice, and the speaking voice is different than the owner of the story. And so there's this kind of dislocation that's being triangulated constantly. And I think that that's it.
Yeah. Whatever. Thanks for that.
I mean, how was that? I don't know. Were you thinking about that whenever you started the piece, Johanna? Yeah, I'll turn it into a question.
I mean, I don't know if I was thinking, I was definitely feeling that. You know, I think if I wasn't feeling that, then I wouldn't have reached out to you and to you. So, yeah, I agree.
Yeah. I mean, I really like that space. I feel like I'm trying to, get to that space a lot, you know? And, I'm really interested in, a death of self. I feel like also, one of the reasons why I also could do this a little bit before someone wrote I got the CCF thing award, and someone wanted to write a blog post about my story because it was interesting and going to prison and stuff like that, and the person who wrote it, he was like, I think it would be better in your voice, so I'm going to write it as your voice. And and it was kind of interesting. At first I was like, I don't know. And what it brought up was all the things I'm trying to hold on to, you know, which is I think one of my main concerns in life is, you know, or the things that concern me most is being overly concerned of how I'm perceived by others and trying to control that. And so allowing that to happen, I think that also helped with this project as well. And I'm really interested in how to fully give up myself. I want to try to find a different way of being or something. And so this project, I don't know, was a space for that. So yeah.
Okay. Hi. Thank you for your presentation. It's really weird for me to talk in a mic, but I'll try today. I guess I'm really interested in sort of the way trust is conceived of in the project, right? It's something that's obviously being discussed right now. The way I kind of come to understand it, it's not necessarily one that gets, I mean, maybe you two or your process among the three of you will allow you to get closer, but it's more about sort of allowing the material or the thing or the fabric to guide the relationship and kind of a collaboration that leaves trust for the material to guide the project. So I'm really excited about that idea, thinking through that not only are the stories being told, but also the actual physical manifestation of the material is getting passed in sort of these different sites and different places over time. And I think what Jennifer, you're pointing to is also really exciting to think about, this idea of kind of how to enter somebody's voice or how to sort of embody that. And I think, and just to say sort of the way this is being conceived feels like the sort of other things that you probably bring into that, whether that's the fictional or the sort of the other crevices that allow your material to seep through, kind of build a collaborative trust that maybe isn't about proximity, isn't about knowledge of the other individual, but it's about sort of trust within a sense of redefining what a process can look like. And I don't know, I find that really very hopeful or on some, you know, collaborative level.
Yeah, totally. I'm glad you brought that up. I feel like when the parts when I had the most trouble was when I was thinking about Johanna as a person or something. I don't know, you know, and I had to let go of that and trust this feeling into it. And then once I start trying to conceptualize Johanna or the experience or something, that's when I had all these blocks, and it was something else. It was this other space that I was had to get into that, some magic space or something, maybe something that kind of you're pointing to about it being shaped by the material or being the experience and devoid of these identities, I guess, or yeah.
Yeah, I also think with trust, I was talking the other day with friends about just what that even means, and someone said it's about knowing someone for a long time, and I was but I don't agree. I think it's something also about defining someone's strength and character that I just feel like knowing you or also knowing what you have gone through, you know, which is also a very traumatic but different form of trauma, made me completely trust you.
Yeah.
Without then, knowing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then I'm thinking about maybe the trauma is a thing that's uniting, you know, and like that, because I feel like everyone has trauma, and this is like a trauma-based world we live in, and everything, like, I feel like a lot of relationships, especially really intimate relationships, are based on shared trauma. Either, like, the trauma of the people involved are similar, or it's, like, somehow, like, I don't know, it's, so I maybe that's, like, the space, you know, the space that, like, trusting the trauma or something. Yeah. Trusting in a space that's really hurtful or something, you know, and like, and not, and like learning, like somehow letting that go.
Yeah. Or knowing we're all here together, right? I think where it's like being a survivor of sorts, where it's like we're all here.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh. The crush?
Different artists that, you know, that you did totally open up being like, hey, there was this cruising crush bond that led us to collide. Do you think that was significant in, you know, the trust building?
I think so. I'm glad you brought that up. I was thinking a lot about desire or something, and desire and how that, yeah. But I mean, I think it was big for you in terms of trusting, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Because I think a lot of times also crushes, they like happen all the time and they can lead into friendship. So I think I trusted in wanting a friendship, and also, you know, who doesn't want to have someone have a crush on you? So I was like, that's cool. And the way you did it was like, I mean, other than the book part, maybe it was honorable.
Yeah. And then maybe I think also the important part is that there was an experience of distrust. You know, there is that the moment of being like, who is this crazy person, and what has this person done? You know, so like an experience of maybe a potentially like the horrible side of trusting someone and having experienced that, and then like coming out of that, I think is also very important as well. So it's like, yeah.
Well, and I think also because I knew your work prior to knowing you, and through your artwork, you learn about your personal story. So I always like that. And I still had many questions, but I feel like I trusted you. I mean, so much so that now I'm teaching at SFAI, and I've invited Jennifer twice to come speak with my students. And I'm going to be back there in the fall, and I'll be inviting you again. And with Lob came last time, too. And like that's something where it's like, usually people be like, I'm going to invite different people, but I love how you speak to them so much that I want all my students to hear you talk and experience you. So.
Why, thank you.
Yeah.
Did we talk about everything that you wanted to talk about?
I think so. I mean, we're over time, yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Okay. Yeah, really good. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? We have to get into it. All right. Thank you all for being here, and thank you so much, Lydia, for this invitation. My talk today is called Diaspora Archives, and it's, you'll have to bear with me, it's very much of a work in progress. It's some research that I've been in the midst of, that I'm kind of using this event as an opportunity to think through some ideas. But one way I want to preface my talk is to say that, you know, when I first received the invitation for the event, I didn't know where it was going to be held. And when I found out that it was at 365 Mission, where we are today, I had to think long and hard about what it meant to present the kinds of questions that I'll be talking about today. Questions regarding colonialism, war, violence, and memory here in this specific building, in this specific part of Los Angeles, on this specific day, April 22, 2016. And so I'm going to let that question linger for a moment while I actually go into the kind of center of my talk and open up by sharing with you that I've been going to a lot of archives lately. For the past year, I've been going to archives across the Pacific Ocean between the Philippines and the United States. And this is the kind of core of what I'll be presenting. But I want to contextualize my practice in a pretty recent work of mine that's called Ex Utero from 2015. And it's a work that actually bears a lot of resonance with the presentation that Johanna and Jennifer just offered us. It deals with the women in my family who have had breast cancer. It poses us nude from the waist up. It enters into family archives. And I'm just going to play a short clip of it for you so you get a sense of what the texture of the video is like. The sound that you're hearing that's kind of overwhelming throughout the video is maybe some sound that some of you are familiar with. It's the sound of a radiation therapy machine. So I'm going to put it on mute and just scroll forward just to show you a little bit about how the work moves. It moves through some negatives, some family photos, throughout there are the voices of me, my mother, and my aunt. And, you know, I think that it's a work that taught me a lot about my practice. On the one hand, I think because it was a subject that was so intimate. And I think that, you know, it shared with me that at the core of my practice is actually is love, and that's actually been something that has been constant from the first works that I made, perhaps 16 years ago. It also taught me that, you know, I'm very interested in memory as it's embodied. the way in which our bodies are our archives of sorts, and how it is that this love that I feel lies at the center of my practice is something that I want to think about today alongside this question of the desire to remember, what it means to explore memory across the intimate sites of self, family, community, and the relation to larger geopolitical forces like colonization, migration, and globalization. My interest in all of this, I think, stems from my own life experience. I myself am an immigrant. My family's story is a story of immigration across the Pacific Rim, first from the Philippines, then to the US territory of Guam, and finally to Los Angeles. And I grew up in Los Angeles. The apartment building where I grew up in on the west side of Los Angeles was actually, this 10-unit stucco apartment building where each and every single unit was occupied by a person from a different country. So there's a way in which this kind of entry into the immigrant, multicultural Los Angeles forms the real conditions of my subjectivity. But also, looking back on all of this today, I think that it's also one of the main reasons why I became an artist. Because from an early age, I understood that to begin anew, while it was filled with hope and possibility, was also filled with tremendous sadness, trauma, and pain. And I feel like in my practice, I've been driven to explore the complexity of these layers, and been also driven to grapple with the histories of colonialism, racism, and genocide that are part of the first, second, and third generation experience of what it means to be in the United States. So all of this has really made it so that my practice is deeply invested in the politics of temporality, how it is that certain understandings of what is past, present, and future also include questions about who are the subjects that are included in what is past, present, and future. And with this focus in mind, I've had to really rethink the question of what is a document and what is an archive. All my videos, since I've started making them, have pretty much worked with documents of one sort or another. I see these documents as a kind of historical spark that opens up a different way to think about our historical present. But more so, I think over the past years, I've come to understand that this work with documents is actually not so much about a looking toward the past, but actually a deep investment in memories of the future. And I think one of the things when I think about how it is that I have come to rethink or expand what I understand as a document, I think each document is almost just a trace of some sort, a kind of iterable trace, meaning each time it emerges again and again in time, it bears a different kind of valence. And documents are not only things that commit words to paper, as we might understand, you opening a Word doc on your computer or something like that, but actually it's a kind of writing that can be attributed to someone or something, and thus kind of shifting it away from a kind of anthropomorphic understanding of writing, right? And in this sense, bodies can be written by the medical industrial complex. Mountains can be written by multinational mining corporations. Or urban spaces can be written by the communities that inhabit them. So it's this understanding of documents that also, I think, opens up that anything can become a document if you think that something has something to say, if there's a kind of a possibility of address that is embedded in that form of writing. And it's in this way that I've come to understand what I've done in my work as someone who engages with documentary, right? Not at all something that deals with simply the politics of truth or the truth form, but actually this whole question about address and response and what it is that we can hear that opens up a kind of rupture within what we understand as the historical present. Furthermore, I think that with this expanded notion of documents, what happens is that archives are everywhere, right? They're not just limited to the institutions of knowledge where some idea of memory is stored and tightly controlled. Those institutions that seem to hold the key to time, to past, present, and future. I think my practice has really been invested in wresting the key to time from those kinds of powers and questioning the kind of powers that would want us to believe that time is irrevocable, unidirectional, or inevitable. I've been really invested in the development of different kinds of archives that bear witness to the tremendous resistance and resilience that characterizes communities in struggle, archives that open onto histories that would otherwise be erased, and whole life worlds that would otherwise be left to the dominant state of amnesia and assimilation that characterizes the experience of any minor group in America. So I feel like we're all involved in this struggle for memory, and that each memory is a kind of rupture into the smooth space of time. So with that, let me move back into the presentation and some of this research that I've been doing lately. Now I'm going to tell you some stories. So part of the reason why I first began entering into archives is because I was really captivated by some of the stories that exist in my family concerning my great-great-grandmother. So the place that we're from in the Philippines is a town that's called Cotabato. It's in the southernmost island of Mindanao. And it's a place that is quite marginalized within the kind of Manila-centric discourse of the Philippines. It's a place that has a long history of struggle. 60% of the indigenous population in the Philippines lives in Mindanao, of which part of the kind of roots of my family are from. We're from the Bangsamoro people. And so my great-great-grandmother, the stories that I was hearing about her were fascinating. For example, there's one story that says that she would disappear for days at a time. She would come back dripping wet. People would say, "Where have you been?" And she would say, "I've been to Mecca." Or other stories like that she was able to walk in the city streets without anyone ever seeing her because she had these powers of invisibility. Or other stories about the way that she wielded these magical powers even after her death, because she has a grave site, and the story goes that a distant uncle had begun taking care of her grave site at a time when he was really down and out in his life. So he was tending to this grave site for months on end, my great-great-grandmother's grave site, and supposedly, you know, his life turned around. Everything became better after he started doing that. So this kind of these magical stories really sparked my imagination. You know, opened up the desire to write about my great-great-grandmother, to kind of mine the question of what kinds of ancestral knowledges existed in these stories, to begin to contextualize these stories within the historical climate in which she lived, which was the moment of Spanish colonialism and U.S. colonialism, and this war, the Philippine-American War, that bridged those two forms of occupation. And that's actually the reason why I started going to all of these archives. On top of that, I would say that just sharing some of, again, my personal history, while I was growing up in that 10-unit stucco building in the west side of Los Angeles, all of my childhood was spent in the saga of immigration, meaning my family was trying to immigrate other members of our family to come to the United States to live here. If any of you are familiar with the saga of immigration, it is an arduous, painful, multi-year process. Sometimes it takes upwards of 25 to 30 years to petition family members legally. And so one of the ways that my family was trying to petition family members more quickly was actually to have my grandmother, my mother's mother, come to the United States, because it's easier to petition family members if you're like a mother child relationship than like a sister brother relationship. So my childhood was full of my grandmother coming and going from Los Angeles to the Philippines, and she did that because she absolutely hated it here. She despised everything about America. And what you see on the screen right now is actually how I remember her spending much of her time when she wasn't complaining about being in the United States, which is that she sewed and she crocheted. So just to kind of tie up the ends of that part of the story, eventually family members were able to migrate. Many of them went back to the Philippines because they decided it wasn't like they had, you know, great or affluent lives there, but they decided that the way of life here was not worth it for them. So there's a kind of opposite American dream experience that I witnessed through this, familial space that I'm narrating right now. One other thing that I just want to mention in terms of this kind of magical matrilineal line is my grandmother, this one who hated America so much, also had stories about her. So supposedly, in the town that we're from again, she would have a table full of sand and a kind of stick, like a stick in the shape of a T. And she would hold the stick in her two hands, and people would come and ask her questions. And at like a medium, the stick would answer their questions. And she was doing that until the Buddhist monk finally said, maybe she shouldn't be doing that anymore, and she stopped. But I really, appreciated this whole way of storytelling and inhabiting life worlds that was outside of the kind of mode of Western rationality, and that I'll eventually, as we're moving forward with these images, begin to tie into what I'm going to discuss in terms of the violence of the U.S. colonial occupation of the Philippines. So here's a map of the island of Mindanao, where my family is from. It's the southernmost island again in Cotabato. The city where we're from is, I can't really. It's kind of on the bottom there, on top of, under Parang. And, you know, as I started entering into different kinds of archives across the Pacific, from the provincial university library to the National Library in Manila to finally, Library of Congress and National Archives in Washington, D.C., you know, definitely the whole experience of what it means to enter into archives began to transform for me. You know, initially I just wanted to find what Cotabato looked like, might have looked like during the time of my great-great-grandmother. And these are some of the images that I found, taken both by a Spanish occupation and American occupation. It's important to note, again, that the indigenous peoples of this area are the Bangsamoro. They come from a long line of roots in Islam. From the 13th century, Islamic missionaries came to the southern Philippines, and so this is the kind of genealogy that I'm also tracing with these images. And so these images that you just saw span something from like the 1880s until I think now we're in the mid-1920s or so. When I said a few moments ago that to look, to think about archives is not necessarily just to think about the past, but it's a profound question about the future, I think I'm certainly influenced by this text by Jacques Derrida. Derrida reminds us that whenever you enter into an archive, it's always a question about institutionalization itself. Furthermore, he reminds us that all archives bear a kind of exteriority, right? It's not just like internal personal memory, but a kind of exterior question about memory. And furthermore, that there's always a kind of technical structure that supports every archive, meaning there's a kind of technology, right? Whether it's there's a kind of way in which these images, for example, that we were looking at, bear the trace of the time in which they were taken by virtue of the technologies that were used. So here's just this quote that I think opens up this idea that, you know, the question of the archive is not just of the past, but an archivable concept of the archive is rather a question of the future, the very question of the future, the question of a response, of a promise, and of a responsibility for tomorrow. The archive, if we want to know what this will have meant, we will only know tomorrow. So here I'm going to run across a bunch of different cultural forms and history for us to situate us again in these questions about past, present, and future that are so central to the research that I'm engaged with. So I've talked about this recording in a number of different iterations in the past, but look it up. It's very interesting. It's a recording by Ernest Tubbs called Filipino Baby, where the song is basically Second World War, and it describes American soldiers looking at an image, a photograph of a Filipina woman, and triangulating their gaze around this image of this woman as a site of sexual availability. This song is a kind of, you know, cultural, you know, it was a popular cultural product that really comes out of a longer genealogy that I'll share with you now. I often situate this song within the context of westward expansion. So here we have the territorial growth of the United States from 1783 to 1850 here in California. Of course, territorial growth and these words that are used here, ceded, can actually be replaced with genocide and slavery. That is the history that we're looking at in this map. And that expansion westward did not stop at the west coast of the United States, but continued across the Pacific Ocean so that Hawaii, Midway Islands, Wake Islands, Guam, and the Philippine Islands were all annexed as part of the U.S. colonial, U.S. Empire. And so when I was actually still very young, still studying as an undergraduate at UC Berkeley, I was already doing archival research there and discovered a book that I think sparked pretty much my whole trajectory thereafter. This was a book from 1914 by a photographer named J.D. Givens, who was a San Francisco-based photographer. He actually had a portrait studio in the Presidio, but he accompanied the US military on their journeys abroad. And one of the places that he went was the Philippines. So he produced a book that was called Our New Possessions in the Philippine Islands, which was published for mass circulation in 1914. So technically, the Philippine-American War, there are varying dates that are very argued in different circles, but technically that took place from 1898 to 1902. Strangely, or maybe tellingly, within all US discourse around that event. It's not called the Philippine American War, it's called the Philippine Insurrection, as if to kind of temper the amount of resistance that existed in the population that the US was trying to occupy. So this book was actually produced some years after that, right? A good maybe 12 years or so. And there were two images that were particularly striking to me and that have haunted me until this present day. This is one of them. This is "Twix, Be No in Love," says the caption. But obviously, there's a kind of a mirroring of that song that I mentioned, "Filipino Baby," where the American soldier with his arm around the Filipina woman, his gaze on her face, and she's basically the Filipina baby, right? She is the site of sexual availability. It's a subject that I have worked with in different capacities and other works of mine. Like I did a video in 2013 called "Basing Landscapes," which actually offers interviews with women who had worked as prostitutes around the former U.S. military bases in Ilonggo and Subic Bay during the time of the U.S. occupation, as well as the voices of environmental activists who are still fighting for the cleanup of these areas that have been left completely decimated because of the kinds of toxicity that the US military left in the Philippines. All of this should bring us very firmly into the present, because in 2015, the re-entry of US military on Philippine bases was actually agreed upon. So there's a whole new kind of basing logic that's taking place in the Philippines today, which tells us that everything that I'm discussing in terms of these historical images, again, it's not of the past, it's of the present and the future. So not only was it this image of the Filipina as a site of sexual availability that has haunted me until the present day, but this image, which is one of father and son. Father and son are posed on the dirt road. You can see from the image that the son's pants have been taken down and a stick has been placed on his behind. So the kind of violence, rape, sodomy, emasculation, all of the kinds of semiotics that I think are layered within this image of father and son are coupled with what had been, during the Philippine-American War, a mandate that all Filipino boys over the age of 10 should be killed because they could remember a time before the United States. So all of this I want you to think about alongside the one image that existed in this volume, Our New Possessions in the Philippine Islands, of a kind of coupling of Filipino man and woman, but in this instance, right, it's a little man and a little girl. So all of this for me, in the years that I've been haunted by these images, you know, it's really opened up deep questions about the kind of logic of U.S. imperialism, a kind of death that I think has been shared in the images and in policy that is really, I think, about cutting off memory, cutting off the future, cutting off the possibility of a Philippines without occupation. And so, you know, in some of the recent work that I've been doing in the archives, you know, that I'm interested in this kind of temporal moment between 1914, when it could only be, you know, this, and this, and this time before, this is a stereograph from like 1898, where, you know, this courtship of sorts between Filipino man and Filipino woman could still be expressed. All of this obviously in this, you know, kind of heterosexual matrix that is part and parcel of this ideology. But, you know, I'm going to move through a bunch of different images now, all of which, almost all of which, are meant for popular circulation. They were meant for popular circulation in the United States as an index of the colony, the possession, a kind of view into the space that we, the United States, now controlled. Like, many colonial logics, all of these archives that I entered into bore this whole kind of categorization, right? Logic of categorization. Oops, sorry about that. And what I discovered too was that this image of dead father and son in 1914 actually had a genealogy from the images taken during the Filipino-American War. So again and again, in these stereographs that were meant for popular circulation in the United States are dead bodies, bodies of dead Filipinos. So dead Filipinos on the battlefield near Malabon. A sacrifice to Aguinaldo's ambition. Aguinaldo was a revolutionary leader. That's the same subtitle. So there's a kind of a necromancy, a kind of way in which these images of death in the Philippines, they're ones that I think about too alongside this image, which is a trench at Badajo. This was a massacre in 1908. Conducted by someone named General Pershing, who actually, all of this actually has very deep resonance for all of the kinds of activity the U.S. has done in relation to extraordinary rendition, Guantanamo, and all of that, all of the things that have been going on in the Middle East for most of our adult lives. This massacre at Badajo, which is again in the island of Mindanao, was conducted by General John Pershing. About 1,000 people were killed, and here is a photograph, right, that bears witness in the U.S. Imperial Archive to the massacre. One of the reasons why I want to stay on it for a moment is because coming back to the great grandmother narrative, this is the time when she was alive. This is a time when she was moving through the streets invisible. This was the time when she would come back from Mecca dripping wet, And coming back to the kind of interest in temporality and how it is that what we understand as the past, present, and future conditions who and who is not included in those times. There was a great anxiety about the future that I think that these imperial images really represent for us. For example, here is an image of quote-unquote future rulers of the Philippine Islands, but of course these are children with no shoes and dressed in a way that I think we can juxtapose with this image. Our young Filipinos in holiday attire. There's a whole kind of sartorial interest within these stereographs that I think is really interesting. Or for example, this one, which says, better class of Filipinos who welcome American rule, right? And again, the kind of dress, the kind of class, this is the kind of comprador elite, right? Who are ushering in and welcoming the occupation. And all of this, how is it that Filipinas are surviving with this kind of ghost, in the background you see all of the American military soldiers looking over at the image in the same way as the women are. And so there's this kind of doubling of the kind of way in which these women are always, within the gaze, both from the front and from the back of the United States and of militarization. So, you know, when I was in many of these archives really searching for what it was like in the island that we're from, you know, images like these opened up of the past, or images like this. But so too did I find a whole mentality right within these archives, because at the National Archive are all of the holdings of a unit that was called the Bureau of Insular Affairs, which was actually the governing body of the Philippines from 1900 to 1939. So it was troves and troves of images that really bear witness to a kind of attempt toward a form of American imperialist modernity. So, for example, many images of prisons. Again, a stereograph meant for popular circulation. Many photographs about the building of hospitals. And for any of you who are familiar with the story of the Philippine diaspora, many of our overseas foreign workers are in the healthcare industry. So there's a really, long history of why that is the case. Many photographs of resources. Types of plants, different places where it might be possible to mine. And finally, many photographs of education. And what was particularly striking to me about these photographs of education was something that I hadn't known before, which is that part of the colonial This drive toward a kind of colonial modernity was not only like schools, but actually to establish kind of craft and embroidery schools for women. So these are some images of those kinds of craft and embroidery schools. And some details of the kind of crochet that the women were taught in these schools. Which brings me back to this pillowcase, because I must admit that, you know, after all of this archival research, I really found my mind deadened, found myself very angry, found myself really asking the question of what. You know, the first thing that you're always asked whenever you go into an archive is, what are you looking for? And if in the beginning I had some answer for that, which is this desire to understand what it looked like, you know, what it might have looked like during the time of my great-great-grandmother, as I continued, I realized that what I was actually, that kind of desire fell away in a certain way, and it became much more about kind of coming face to face with the forms of knowledge and institutionalization and power structures that exist within the archiving of materials in these kinds of institutional spaces. So it was actually a moment when I encountered these images of these, the embroidery schools and these details of them of the crochet, that I realized it was two different archives meeting, right? It was the colonial archive and their cataloging of their modernity, and it was the archive that exists in my body and my memories of my grandmother and our immigrant experience and the way in which I was entering those archives from a stance and from a perspective that was looking for something different. And I would say that that difference, you know, it has to do with many things. I think on the one hand, I'm thinking about, you know, if this needlepoint was a kind of colonial education of sorts for my grandmother, there's certainly a way that it transformed for her in terms of salving the kind of pain that I think she was experiencing as a migrant here in the United States. And it certainly transformed for me in this being the only thing that I have left of my grandmother today. So how is it that these kinds of colonial knowledge transform, transmute, become our own, become deterred, become something different? How do such, you know, I began by narrating these kind of magical stories of my maternal line and also by showing you the video that deals with breast cancer, my mother, my aunt, and myself. And so, you know, I'm very, I guess I'm moving around this question of ancestral knowledge. You know, these knowledges that we hold in our bodies, these sites of incredible resistance and resilience amongst ourselves, in our communities, that allow us to survive and that allow us to perhaps even thrive and to continue and to share and to open up different ways of thinking and being in the world that are so necessary for our contemporary moment. I'm asking questions about different ways of archive making, right? If there are these institutions that hold the key to these kinds of images that bear witness to the atrocities of the past that our peoples have had to bear, what are the different forms of archive making that are possible? What are anti-colonial archives? What are decolonial archives? How do we begin to imagine those together? And I think one of my biggest questions, being the daughter of immigrants, is also this question of where are the diaspora's archives? You know, if part of the logic of immigration, part of the logic of imperialism, part of the state of war that we're living in is grounded in amnesia and forgetting, you know, for me, this is a real kind of indication about that part of the struggle that we're engaged in today is a struggle for memory, and that part of that memory has to be opening up this question of thinking about archives differently and thinking about how archives exist in an era of globalization. So, you know, I think in closing, I would say that I struggle to keep memory alive, not to have an accurate record of the past, but instead to facilitate an opening, however brief, to imagine different possible futures. And I want to return to the point with which I began, which is what does it mean to speak about colonization, war, violence, and memory here in this specific building, in this specific part of the city of Los Angeles, on this specific day, April 22, 2016? It means to remember that just down the street on Whittier and Hollins, a family has been evicted by the new owner of their building because this family, who has lived in this unit for 16 years, supposedly has two extra people living in their unit. These two extra people are children, only 10 and 11 years old. The new owner of the building claims that he can evict them because the two children are not on the lease. Yet there was never a lease to begin with. And the previous owner knew that these children were there, and the manager did as well, and no one had any objections. So the ugly truth is that the owner wants to evict this family so that he can rent to people who are wealthier. This is part of the violence of gentrification that is taking place across Los Angeles and is being felt in very harsh ways here in Boyle Heights and Northeast Los Angeles. This is part of the global war on the poor that we are a part of, convening here in this space, 365 Mission Today. One thing that Boyle Heights is also experiencing along with the violent displacement of poor people is the proliferation of art galleries, both for-profit and non-profit, whose way of talking about and engaging with the communities that they have entered into seems to emerge straight from the colonial archive. Some speak as if this is a kind of unpeopled frontier or an autonomous zone. Others peddle in the thrill of the dangerous quality of the area, while perhaps some of the most insidious rhetorics actually emerge paternalistically and claim to want to represent difference. And it's a way that white liberalism continues to produce deadly forms of diversity. So I think, you know, students from a local charter school here in Boyle Heights that's called Calo Youth Build make the point very eloquently. Sergio Quintaro, who's a student coordinator for an art action that took place around this area called Art Ambulante, says, quote, that besides my family being displaced, unfortunately, there are many more getting evicted or rents rising way above what they can afford, so they have no option but to move. It's a topic that should be widely talked about and has to be fought to save our neighborhood and the culture that lives within it. So make no mistake, today, April 22, 2016, we sit in the middle of a war zone. All of this whiteness that surrounds us, this is a war zone. And in the middle of this is a profound struggle being fought for survival and for liberation. Ashia Mbembe has said that the present is actually the site of a tremendous absence. All the people who have been absented, made absent in order for the present to maintain itself. So there's a profound urgency for us to consider the kinds of times in which we understand the present, and we have to ask who is being absented in order for this present to proceed. Thank you. I don't know how much time we have. Do we have time for questions, or should we? Okay. I can take two questions.
Sitting here being like, thanks for changing the tone in the room and just bringing it home into all of our bodies, or I'm assuming a lot of us are feeling it in our bodies, but with your questions, and I guess something I'm thinking about is, did you read that book David Forbes where he talks about Columbus, and he's Lakota Indian and he grew up in these lands, and he talks about the Wetiko, you know, disease that, you know, Columbus and colonialism is cannibalism. That to take someone's property, or which is their body, for one's own gain, right, which is what I understand an imperial has been like, the history of imperialism. And I was looking at your images and I just was thinking about the disease of the Wetiko, that the cannibalism of the globe. And I was thinking about how then those bodies go into the ground, and I was thinking about the blood that goes into the ground. And then I was thinking about the food that's grown in the ground. And then in this cycle that we are contaminated, we are possibly all in this room, part of this Wetiko illness. And you said something at the beginning about love. And I want to ask that both very naively and genuinely about, as you're imagining touring through this past, which you're asserting is the present, I mean, what do you find in terms of the binding ground for an imaging future that you desire? Or do you want to share your desire of an imaging future of that sort?
I feel like the future is something that we are all making together at every moment. And I feel like what I desire are the kinds of processes that open up possibility for different futures. Which is to say that the futures that I desire, sure, you know, I could talk about them. I could talk about the kind of ecological crisis that's taking place around the world. And by ecology, we don't just talk about, you know, the decimation of environmental habitats, but also the people who live in those habitats, and the kind of way in which the most vulnerable populations are the poorest ones in all different kinds, all different parts of the world, right? So I feel like that future making, future imagining needs to really take into consideration the question of who is involved in that conversation about the future, and that those people who are, within those most kind of vulnerable situations need to be at the center of the table and calling the kind of terms of what that future might look like. So I guess there's a kind of deep desire for that orientation toward a future that opens up the space of each of our profound responsibilities within this moment. But I would stop short of naming what that looks like. Great, thank you very much.
Okay, buenas tardes a todos. Nomás quería empezar por decirle gracias a la tía y a todos por estar aquí. Estamos muy felices por poder presentar y compartir esta obra con ustedes.
So we just wanted to start by saying thank you for la tía and for everyone for being here, for the invitation and the opportunity to present our work and this particular piece. Prólogo.
Prologue.
Dialegestai, de día, a través, y legein, habla.
Dialegestai, from día, through, and legein, speech.
El punto del cual brotan las palabras dialéctico y diálogo.
The source from which the words dialectic and dialogue emerge. Dialectic, a system that seeks to construct knowledge by establishing, refining, and attempting to synthesize contradictory hierarchic forms.
Dialéctico, sistema que plantea la búsqueda del conocimiento en relación a establecer, esclarecer, y buscar sintetizar formaciones contradictorias jerárquicas.
A system based on identifying and transcending borders. Dialectic.
Un sistema basado en la identificación de fronteras y su trascender, dialéctico. Diálogo, el conversar.
Dialogue, to speak with.
Proceso conectivo que crea un lazo entre sujetos, creando intersecciones entre sistemas paralelos, explotando aproximaciones y revelando afinidades desconocidas. Diálogo.
The connective system that links subjects, establishing intersections between parallel systems, exploiting approximations and revealing unknown affinities. Dialogue. Delegestai. Encounter of concept with action.
Encuentro entre concepto y acción. Delegestai.
To speak with, between, through, and in spite of delimitations.
El hablar entre, a través, con, y a pesar de delimitaciones.
What will be said?
¿Qué se dirá?
One, parable of the clothesline, or a line stretched between two points suspended above the level of the ground.
Uno, parábola del tendedero, o una línea estirada entre dos puntos suspendida sobre el nivel del suelo. Cerco, de latín circus, círculo, del mismo origen que circo. A la misma familia etimológica pertenecen cerca, adverbio, próximo a otro que se toma como referencia. Circular, adjetivo, que tiene forma de círculo. Circular, verbo, andar o moverse siguiendo una dirección o un trayecto determinado. Moverse dentro de un circuito o a través de un conducto. Pasar de unas personas a otras. Y todos los derivados con el prefijo circum, alrededor. De latín, circulare, redondear, o circulari, formar grupo.
Cerco, fence. From the Latin circus, meaning circle. From the same origin as circus. Part of the same etymological families as words meaning close, proximate, to circulate, flow, to move around, to make round, to form a group. Fence. Origin Middle English, in the sense of defending. Shortening of defense, noun. The action of defending from harm or danger or resisting attack. From Old French, defends, past participle of defender, defend. From di, off, and vender, to strike, to evade strike. From the Latin, defensum, meaning neuter. From Latin, neuter, meaning neither, not either.
Fence, cerco. Origen, en el sentido de defender, truncación de defensa. La acción de defender contra daño o peligro. Del francés, defendere, evadir ataque o golpe. Del latín, defensum, castrar. Del latín, neuter, ni uno ni otro.
In the 80s, my maternal grandparents lived with their six children on 2nd Street in Calexico.
En los años 80, mis abuelos maternos vivían con sus seis hijos en la calle Segunda, en Calexico.
They lived parallel to a fence that separated the city from Mexicali.
Vivían de frente al cerco que dividía la ciudad de Mexicali.
This fence demarcated the international jurisdiction between the United States and Mexico.
El cerco demarcaba la jurisdicción internacional entre los Estados Unidos y México.
But it was just a fence.
Pero era solo un cerco.
And like all fences,
y como todos los cercos,
it enclosed an arbitrary territory.
Encerraba un territorio arbitrario.
At an arbitrary height.
A una estatura arbitraria.
The fence is not infinite.
Este cerco no es infinito.
It is not monolithic.
No es monolítico.
Like all fences, this fence invites transgression.
Y como todo cerco, invita la transgresión.
Many people jump the fence.
Muchas personas se brincaban el cerco.
But because the people came from the other side of the fence.
Pero porque estas personas venían del otro lado del cerco.
And on that side of the fence, they didn't have all the same things that the people like my family had on our side.
Y de ese lado del cerco no tenían las mismas cosas que gente como mi familia tenía de nuestro lado.
Or because they had ruined all their belongings in the process of getting over the fence.
o porque habían arruinado sus cosas en el transcurso de cruzar.
They often didn't blend in with the our side of the fence people, and they'd get sent back over to the other side.
Se notaba que no eran como la gente de nuestro lado del cerco, y cuando esto sucedía, se les regresaba a su lado.
Because of this dire need to have objects that would allow them to blend in on our side.
Debido a esta necesidad de tener cosas que les permitirían pasar desapercibidos de nuestro lado.
So that they could remain.
Para poder permanecer.
These people who were tired and hurt and weary from their trip over the fence.
Estas personas agotadas y dolidas por el viaje que emprendieron para cruzar.
Would look to my family's clothesline.
Miraron hacia el tendedero de mi familia.
One morning in September, my grandmother went to the clothesline that stood parallel to the fence.
Una mañana en septiembre, mi abuela salió al tendedero posicionado en paralelo al cerco.
She went to fetch a new silk dressing robe that she was given for her birthday.
Fue a recoger su nueva bata de seda que había recibido para su cumpleaños.
She had set it out to dry overnight so that the sun's rays wouldn't dull its colors.
La había dejado secar de noche para que los rayos del sol no opacaran su color.
In its place, she found a tattered men's shirt.
En su lugar, encontró una camisa de hombre deshilachada.
Stained with sweat.
Teñida de sudor.
And dirt.
Y tierra.
Another day, my mother sulked on her way to school knowing that she would be reprimanded because she didn't have a physical education uniform to wear that day.
Otro día, mi madre caminó triste a la escuela sabiendo que la regañarían porque no tenía su uniforme para la clase de educación física.
Since the day before, it had been taken by a person from the other side of the fence.
Ya que el día anterior había sido tomado por una persona del otro lado del cerco.
And in its place, she found some dirty pants hanging on the clothesline.
Y colgando el tendedero en su lugar, había encontrado un par de pantalones sucios.
And so it went.
Y así fue.
A dress shirt for a pair of torn up boots.
Una camisa por un par de botas.
New socks exchanged for a hat with a broken brim.
Calcetines nuevos intercambiados por un sombrero con la ala rota.
A ruffled blouse.
Una blusa con pliegues.
For a fuchi plaid button down.
Por una camisa escocesa fuchilona.
Over time,
con el tiempo,
my family, especially my grandmother, became more savvy about what was left on the clothesline, strategic even.
Mi familia, y en especial mi abuela, empezó a ser más consciente, casi estratégica, de lo que se dejaba en el tendedero.
I don't, for instance, think that she ever dried any of her nice church blouses outside.
Por ejemplo, no creo que sacaba a secar blusas que se ponía para ir a la iglesia.
But always hung what she found to be a very tasteless pair of velour pants that my grandfather wore on casual outings.
Pero siempre, siempre colgaba un par de pantalones de velvetón que mi abuelo se ponía para salir a pasear.
My family always reminds me that there was no stealing involved in these interactions.
Mi familia me recuerda que estas interacciones no constituían robos.
That it was an exchange that happened out of necessity for survival.
Sino una forma de intercambio que surgió debido a la necesidad de sobrevivir.
The clothesline became the space.
El tendedero se convirtió en el espacio.
Where we could recognize.
Donde todos podían reconocer.
Their other side of the fenceness as simply that.
Que el ser del otro lado del cerco era simplemente eso.
A position in relation to a fence.
Una posición en relación a un cerco. Dos, una de mis primeras memorias, consecuencia del formar un sentido de país.
Two, one of my first memories, a consequence of forming a sense of country.
Mi madre dejó su casa en Huatabampo, Sonora, a los 18 años, y se mudó junto con uno de sus hermanos a Tijuana, donde encontró trabajo en un concesionario Ford, trabajando como secretaria.
My mother left her house in Huatabampo, Sonora, when she was 18 years old, and moved with one of her brothers to Tijuana, where she began working at a Ford dealership as a secretary.
A los 4 años, me llevó a conocer a mis abuelos.
When I was 4 years old, she took me to meet my grandparents.
Viajamos desde Los Ángeles en un pickup con camper alfombrada que mi padre había restaurado recientemente.
We traveled from Los Angeles in a pickup truck with a carpeted camper in the back that my dad had recently renovated.
En ese viaje, conocí a mi primo.
During that trip, I met my cousin.
Era de mi misma edad y aficionado de las artes marciales.
We were the same age, and he was a martial arts aficionado.
Lo cual descubrí cuando me sometió a un candado Kimura en la camper de nuestra troca, después de que nuestros tíos nos incitaron a unas luchitas.
I discovered this when he put me in a Kimura lock in the camper of our truck after being egged on by our uncles to wrestle.
Creo que querían ver cómo le iba el sobrino Chonchito del otro lado con el sobrino Maiciado que a diario hacía sparring con ellos.
I think they wanted to see how their chubby nephew from the other side would fare against their corn-fed nephew who would spar with them on a regular basis.
Conforme el candado aplicado se cerraba,
as the submission lock was tightened,
la presión que sentía incrementaba.
The pressure I felt increased.
Y sin saber cómo escapar, me puse a llorar.
And not knowing how to escape, I began to cry.
Esta es una de mis memorias más tempranas.
This is one of my earliest memories.
El ser sometido a un candado de jiu-jitsu en el desierto sonorense.
Being locked in a jiu-jitsu submission in the Sonoran Desert.
Recientemente, al estar investigando el origen de la palabra articulación,
recently, as I was doing research into the origin of the word articulation,
me topé con una imagen de una enciclopedia del siglo pasado para mujeres.
I came upon an image from an antique women's encyclopedia.
La imagen servía como ilustración para la sección titulada Jiu-Jitsu para mujeres y contaba con la siguiente descripción.
The image was an illustration for the section titled Jiu-Jitsu for Women and had the following caption.
A través de esta sujeción y de este torcer,
by means of this grip and twist,
se cierra la coyuntura del codo.
The elbow joint is locked.
Y la víctima es incapaz de librarse.
And the victim is unable to release herself.
La imagen fue publicada en 1910, el mismo año en que empezó la Revolución Mexicana y el año en el que Shinzo Harada, jefe de los migrantes japoneses en México, fue llamado por el secretario de Guerra y Marina para enseñar en el colegio militar a los cadetes.
The image was published in 1910, the same year that the Mexican Revolution began, and the year that Shinzo Harada, a Japanese migrant leader in Mexico, was called upon by the Mexican Secretary of War and Navy to teach martial arts to cadets in the military college.
Cadetes, entre los que se contaron, los hijos de Don Porfirio Díaz, cuya dictadura terminó con el alzamiento popular revolucionario.
Among these cadets were the sons of Porfirio Díaz, the dictator deposed by the popular revolutionary uprising.
En 1926, otro profesor japonés, Nabutaka Sataka, vino a México a impartir clases de jiu-jitsu a maestros normalistas de la recientemente establecida Escuela Normal Superior, por orden del presidente Plutarco Elías Calles, general revolucionario del estado de Sonora.
In 1926, Nabutaka Sataka, another Japanese teacher, came to Mexico to teach jiu-jitsu to teachers at the recently established Normal Superior School for Teachers by order of President Plutarco Elias Calles, a revolutionary general from the state of Sonora.
Maestros aprendiendo jiu-jitsu en una institución nacida de la Revolución Mexicana.
Teachers learning jiu-jitsu at an institution born from the Mexican Revolution.
Una escuela que, según un académico e historiador, pretendía entrenar a maestros rurales para dar a los mexicanos sentido de país.
A school that, according to one academic and historian, taught to train rural teachers to give Mexicans a sense of country and nation.
El maestro enseñaba lo mismo a leer y a escribir que a hacer jabón o carpintería.
The teacher would teach reading and writing, as well as soap making and carpentry.
¿Por qué no también artes marciales?
Why not martial arts as well?
Jiu, suave, ágil, flexible, maleable o blando.
Jiu, gentle, soft, supple, flexible, pliable or yielding.
Jutsu, arte o técnica.
Jutsu, art or technique.
Jiu-jitsu, arte que utiliza y manipula la fuerza del contrincante en su contra, en lugar de confrontarla con fuerza propia.
Jiu-jitsu, art that uses and manipulates the energy of the enemy against them, instead of confronting it with one's own strength.
De su entrada enciclopédica de Wikipedia. El jiu-jitsu se desarrolló en el Japón antiguo como manera de combatir a samurái, un método para derrotar a un contrincante que porta arma y armadura, sin la necesidad de utilizar armas o con solo una arma corta. debido a que la armadura de los contrincantes en este contexto hacía inútil el utilizar armas, los practicantes aprendieron que los métodos más eficaces para neutralizar al enemigo conllevaba el sujetar y aplicar candados a coyunturas.
From its entry in Wikipedia, Jiu-Jitsu developed to combat the samurai of feudal Japan as a method for defeating an armed and armored opponent in which one uses no weapon or only a short weapon. Because striking against an armored opponent proved ineffective, practitioners learned that the most efficient methods for neutralizing an enemy took the form of holds, pins, and joint locks.
De muy temprana edad, comprendí lo que es el ser sometido a un candado.
From an early age, I understood what it was to be put into a submission lock.
Pero hasta ahora, voy aprendiendo cómo escapar.
But it isn't until now that I'm learning how to escape.
Estableciendo cercanía.
Establishing proximity.
Contorsionando el cuerpo y la lengua.
Contorting one's body and tongue.
Para rearticular los límites impuestos a una articulación de la cual ha sido removida toda flexibilidad.
To rearticulate the limitations imposed upon a joint from which all flexibility has been removed.
A través de esta sujeción y de este torcer,
by means of this grip and this twist,
se abre la coyuntura.
The joint is unlocked.
Y la víctima es capaz de librarse.
And the victim is able to release themselves.
Thank you.
Thank you. Gracias.